So the correct diagnosis is choice E, multiple sclerosis. And let's look at some of the image features make MS the best choice among these five answers here. So as you can see, there are multiple lesions, intramedullary core lesions, that's bright on T2 and STIR. And each of them has relatively short segment. They are shorter than 2 vertebral body height, which is pretty typical for MS lesion. As you can see, second lesion is also shorter than 2 vertebral body height, so multiple short-segmented intramedullary lesion. On the cross-sectional, you can see that the lesion is located in the periphery of the spinal cord rather than central. As you remember, the peripheral of the cord is where the white matter is, and the central is the gray matter, kind of flip of what you see with brain MR. So multiple lesion, short segment, peripheral in location, that is fairly classic for MS lesion. And in addition, you can see that one of the lesions shows enhancement. So patient has evidence of active or recent demyelination. In fact, you can see a second lesion that also shows enhancement, which is a little bit harder to see on the peripheral of the image. That's right at the junction between pons and medulla. So patient has multiple enhancing lesions, suggest active or recent demyelination. I think it's worth knowing about McDonald's diagnostic criteria for MS. Now there are two sets of criteria for MS lesions. One is so-called dissemination in space, which just means that lesion occupying different spaces, multiple lesions. Also dissemination in time. That means that the lesion behaves differently, whether it's a new lesion or same lesion behave differently on a later event. So for dissemination in space, McDonald criteria single out four types of lesion: periventricular, cortical juxtacortical, infratentorial, and spinal cord lesion. If you see two out of four category, you should have higher index suspicion that the lesion you're looking at may be MS lesions. In our particular case, you can see a core lesion. You can see there are multiple periventricular lesions. There's a core lesion, excuse me, there's a cortical lesion, and there's an infratentorial lesion. So in our case, we actually fulfill all four categories of the McDonald criteria for dissemination in space. Also for dissemination in time, there are two scenarios that can qualify for dissemination in time. One of them is that if you have two sets of images, on the baseline image, on the subsequent image, if you see a new T2 lesion or previous lesion that shows new enhancement, that qualifies dissemination in time. Or you don't even need to have two sets of images. You can have just a single set of image, like in our case, where some lesion enhances, other lesion do not. So within the same images, if you have a lesion that behaves differently in terms of enhancement and no enhancement, that can also qualify as dissemination in time. So in our patient, we have the diagnosis of MS. What about other choices that do not work as well in this case? So for choice A, NF2. NF2, as you recall, produce multiple schwannoma, meningioma, and pentamoma. So if you see multiple intramedullary core lesion in the setting of NF2, this is a pentamoma. But if you look at the cross-sectional image, as you remember, our lesion is eccentric or peripheral in location, whereas NF2 or a pentamoma, they are derived from the pentamoma lining of the central canal. So for a pentamoma, they tend to be more centrally located within the spinal cord. And if you think about other type of more common corneoplasm, such as astrocytoma, then astrocytoma compared to a pentamoma does occur in the periphery of the spinal cord more often than the central part of the spinal cord. For neoplasm, whether it's a pentamoma or astrocytoma, they tend to be a lot more expansile than this, and they often show some degree of enhancement. Not always, but they usually show some degree of enhancement. So based on its location and the fact that the cord doesn't look all that expansile, I would not consider the NF1, excuse me, NF2 or pentamoma as a better choice here. So for acute core ischemia, again, our patient has a lesion that involving peripheral of the spinal cord. For acute infarction, such as in this case, a 60-year-old female with core infarction, because the gray matter tend to reside within the central part of the spinal cord, the part that tend to be affected is the gray matter, so therefore central portion usually produce this rounded appearance that is dubbed as the L's eye sign. So this does not look like the classic picture for acute core ischemia, does not involve in the central core, especially if you consider infarction caused by anterior spinal artery infarction. For transverse myelitis, this is an example of 8-year-old with transverse myelitis. They tend to be much more longer segmented compared to MS lesion. In this case, you have a lesion that's greater in 3 vertebral body length. And also on the cross-sectional image, rather than involvement of the peripheral of the spinal cord, transverse myelitis tend to involve in the entire core, or at least the gray matter and some of the white matter involved. So in this particular case, the entire core is involved, and also they tend to be more expansile compared to an MS lesion. So transverse myelitis in this case would not be a better choice than MS. For choice D, vitamin B12 deficiency or the subacute combined degeneration, that is a lesion that classically involves in the dorsal column. So if you see involvement of symmetric dorsal column, think about subacute combined degeneration. And the vitamin B12 deficiency can be due to chronic alcohol abuse, metformin, or nitric oxide abuse. But there's also other entity or other toxic metabolic process that can cause this dorsal column involvement. Some of the example including syphilis or the tabes dorsalis, HIV myelopathy, copper deficiency, even vitamin E deficiency sometimes can mimic vitamin B12 deficiency. And some of the more rare but also important cause is intrathecal methotrexate toxicity, which probably most of you are familiar with the white matter involvement in the brain, but they can also affect the spinal cord, particularly dorsal column. So as generalization for multiple sclerosis, for the purpose of board exam, they should show you multiple core lesions that's short segmented and also peripheral in location. So this is a classic example for MS lesion. That's all for this spine case number 6. Thank you for your attention and good luck on your board exam.